The Everly Brothers and Bye Bye Love. Parker was the man's name.
Everything is ready, m'lady.
Enormous entry for that, still coming through, but the competition is now closed. The three winners, each getting a copy of the book on the making of Thunderbirds. Francis Close from Cushendall. Colin Young from Larne. And Christopher Boyd, who's aged all of 6 years, who phoned from Ballymoney. Congratulations to you all. Commiserations if you didn't make it this time. Besides, do have a wee shifty at it. Little interesting bits and pieces there. Have to get a new competition up as well, because the other one has been won. And that's just about it for now. I'll put the shutters up and we'll get swept up and cleared up and leave you to the tender, loving care of the man who didn't make Thunderbirds, Gerry Anderson.
The only reason I didn't make it is because I didn't have time.
You weren't there.
I wasn't there, no, of no. course. You remembered, of course. It's way before my time.
Yes, yes.
So what is wrong with football?
How long have you got?
Come on.
They don't play it. Did you listen to what I said?
No.
Play it in the wrong place. They should play it in the streets.
The way we used to.
Yes.
But see, look at the dizzy heights you reached. Were you not apprentice in Glentoran? What did you do?
Sandown Boys Club.
Come on, come on. You played for Glentoran, didn't you?
I used to clean the boots.
Come on, be honest now. Don't be hiding your light behind a bushel.
You always hark back to this.
I do. Yeah. I want to know.
Did you ever play for Derry City? They wait
more. There's 16 team in Derry Stoke Londonderry called Arsenal. I played one match and I scored.
What?
It was an own goal. And I was taken off. I lost the head. I got the ball in front of the net. And you know, my reflexes kicked in and I kicked it into the net, never dreaming for one moment.
You'd forgotten to turn around at half.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But what position who did you play for? No, seriously.
What position did you play?
I was a dangerous inside right.
Inside out?
No, I was a dangerous inside right, I said.
Were you a schemer?
No, I was a playmaker. And you're a widowmaker. Where did you, come on, come on. You played for somebody, didn't you?
Shut up. Go away.
You did.
Go
I know away. You don't
I
like,
didn't
talking,
like
about
to talk about
this. No, you're innate modesty. Didn't you play for Glentoran or Glenavon?
Give over.
Who did you play for?
Both.
Both?
Yes.
Yeah, well, what position did you play?
Centre forward, striker.
Well, there you
straight
are.
Up
you
the
see,
middle.
What are you ashamed of?
I was known as the terror of the upfield.
The red streak. No, but did you? What is your record? Did you score any goals?
I don't talk about things.
Go on.
No.
Sure,
no.
If it was George Jones, you'd never shut up about
it. You'll have to read the memoirs when they come.
Whenever you write them.
Have you written your autobiography? You've done yours, haven't
you? I have written them. I'm sure you haven't read it anyway.
I'm not in it. Sure, I'm not.
No, you're not, actually. No, so no. Why should you read it? Yeah. No, come on, tell me. No. You played for Glentoran and Glenavon as the red streak, the striker.
Shut up, the income tax.
And did you score? Did you take part in any major competitions? Did you play in Europe? Did you play in the FA Cup? Or what do you call the FAA Cup, whatever you call it? You're not... Hello?
Hello?
You don't speak about anything.
I'm bored.
I know you are. You don't like talking about yourself. No, but I like talking about you because I admire you a lot. You know that, don't
you?
You
do, you?
I
Which
do.
Particular part of me do you admire?
No, I admire your sporting record.
Mm.
See, I've never had one.
Yeah.
Apart from... What do you want to know what George Best did? Georgie boy. That's the only sporting record I ever had.
Mm. I was a long jumper, you see.
As well?
Yeah, oh yes.
I didn't know that.
Oh yes.
Really?
Oh yeah.
There's no really supplementary question after that. You know, all you do is say, really?
That's what that dog Churchill does in the ads. Says, oh yes.
Oh yes. Oh yes. Oh yes. A long jumper. Now, I know a bit about that because I used to be a long, what do you call the hop, step and jump? They don't call that anymore.
Triple jump.
Triple jump. Well, when I was at the Christian Brothers, they used to call the hop, step and jump. And if you didn't go quick enough, they used to hit you.
Well, in America, they're known as broad jumpers, but we'll not go into that.
Hey?
Hey?
Nudge, nudge.
And with
How's
that,
your
they,
father?
They sped off.
Broad jumpers? They do that in Las Vegas.
Yes.
And another thing. Did you create any kind of a record as a broad jumper? Did you?
Yeah.
No, but seriously, are you a 13-foot man?
This conversation is now closed.
No, but I seem to remember 13-foot has been a very respectable long jump, wasn't it?
Aye, if you were 10.
Well, that's what I was.
13-foot, that's a high jump you're thinking of.
No, I tell you what, I was a good high jumper. I could open my legs, I'm telling you, to some tune.
I've heard. Are you going to do a program or shall I continue?
Go away
now,
you're no fun. You're no fun, you won't talk about anything.
Sean Coyle's not there and you're going mad, aren't you?
You're no fun. Right, go, I mightn't talk to you tomorrow. You're no fun.
Put that in writing. The Barbie doll time. No, I can't swig that sweet champagne. I'd rather drink beer. Or in a honky tonk, or on a four-wheel drive tailgate. I've got
hell yeah from the redneck girls like me. Hell yeah!
Hell yeah!
Victoria's Secret, well, their stuff's real nice. Oh, but I can buy the same damn thing on a Walmart shelf half price and still look sexy. Designer tag to make my man want me.
I told
you. You might think I'm trashy, a little too hardcore, but in my neck of the woods, I'm just a girl next door. Hey, I'm a redneck woman, I ain't no high class broad. I'm just a product of my race, and I say hey y'all and hee haw, and I keep my Christmas lights on. From the redneck girls like me.
Hell yeah!
Hell yeah!
Hell yeah!
Hell yeah!
Hell yeah!
I said hell yeah!
That's what I like, a messy ending. That's Gretchen Wilson. That's a song called Redneck Woman for an album which is called, doesn't say here, but apparently it's a big hit in America. Good song, that Redneck Woman. Plenty of them about here if you look quick enough. Anyway, good morning. Gerald Michael Anderson here. It's Monday morning. It's miserable and it's cold and it's wet, as it always is every day this summer. So it's another long, wet summer's day ahead. The number to ring if you want to contact this program is 08459-555-678. And remember, we do value your calls. You're important to us. And thank you for not smoking. It's 08459-555-678. Geraldine, and what do you call that other wee girl?
Emma
is is there. As I know, all the little girls in there today.
No, just Emma.
I always miss the little ones that you don't know. 08459-555-678. Or indeed, the email facility is open to all Catholic or Protestant. We don't care what your beliefs are. We'll read everything. It's jerry.anderson@bbc.co.uk. And don't hesitate to do it, because after all, it is your BBC. And the text messaging service, which I don't see and which I don't allow to have near me, is 81771. But you'll feel better if you send a message. It's like Big Brother. Right, here's some email messages already. A lady, for no apparent reason, Maria, tells me that Cremor Halt is beside Trolin's petrol station and Super Value on the Cremor Road. I have no idea why she should tell me that, but obviously it was important at some stage in her life. Right, yo, Jerry, says a man who shall be called Paul. This is your building site correspondent checking in. I had nothing to report, actually, but I was shocked at the statement you made on your show last Friday. When I heard it, my jaw hit the deck. Just like the upper torso does when he sees a pair of double D's. You stated that a woman whom I admired and looked up to for inspiration in raising a child is my wife, and I, or indeed, did not even exist. That she's a figment of someone else's imagination. That woman is no other than Rosie Ryan, mother of Bon Jovi. How could this be, my wife? How could this be? A little punctuation would be handy here. How could this be? My wife and I have been to Clocher many times to see if we could meet her, as she has been our mentor, but it all makes sense now. I mean, the woman was a genius. She could string big sentences together and use big words. I needed a book beside me to translate some of the words, for God's sake. She's an inspiration to us all, but alas, it's all fake, like George Jones. You're right, Jerry. This world of show business is all false, and you have to take it with a pinch of pepper. Next, you'll be telling me that Sean Coyle is really a man. No, never. Or that Mrs. Miller is dead. No, she's not dead. She just smells funny. And while we're on the subject, please play the girl from Ipanema. It's great. Someday she'll get the high notes. Speaking of Mrs. Miller, of course. Must go now, Jerry. Phone your jam, cream buns, cream buns. Phone your jam, phone your jams. It's all ahead of like a man in the wheelbarrow. It's all ahead of like a man in the wheelbarrow. Listening to your show, driving back from Belfast, you played a record by a guy called Carl Verheyen. It was an absolutely brilliant piece of music, and I was wondering if you could tell me what was the name of the track you played and if you know what album it is on. Yes, I know all that. Thank you also for the information that he's actually playing here in a few weeks. It should be a great gig, I'm sure. I may go along to the lessons beforehand. Oh, yes, please do. I talked about that the other day. Carl Verheyen, just about, I think, the best guitar player I've ever heard. Certainly the best I've ever heard, and one of the, I'd say, the top five guitar players in the world. And this piece of music is called, yes, it is. It's the Beatles song, and it's from an album called Where Blues Meets Rock Number 5. And it's the label is called Provogue, P-R-O-V-O-G-U-E, Provogue. Maybe I shouldn't say that. I'll tell you what, the man sent me an email. I will send you a little phone number to contact those people and they will send it to you. And funnily enough, Carl Verheyen will be appearing in this very programme, playing live, on Friday the 6th of August, which is the same day as he's doing a gig in the Ulidia Integrated College in Carrickfergus. And he's doing a gig the night before, Thursday, Friday. These people are fantastic. And they're also going to be there all week and giving seminars and indeed workshops. So all you have to do is ring Ulidia College, Ulidia Integrated College in Carrickfergus for all the information. It's a very special one-off. They did this last year, but they didn't stay as long last year. They just played a couple of gigs and then they did a couple of workshops. But this year, they're going to stay here the whole week. And they're also doing another gig. They're playing on Tuesday the 3rd up here in the northwest in McGroys County in County Donegal and Kildare. This is
yeah.
If you wear red tonight, remember what I said tonight. For red is the color that my baby wore, and once more it's true. Yes, it is. Scarlet were the clothes she wore. Everybody knows, I'm sure. I would remember all the things we planned. Understand it's true. Yes, it is, it's true. Yes, it is. I could be happy with you by my side. If I could forget her, but it's my pride.
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is.
Oh, yes, it is. Yeah.
Please don't wear it. Baby,
my pride.
Yes, it is.
Yes, it is.
Oh, yes, it is. Yeah.
Please don't wear red tonight. Yeah, this is what I said, baby. That's gonna make me blue. In spite of you, it's true. Yes, it is. It's true. Yes, it is. It's true.
You're not gonna hear any better than that anywhere, and you can hear that live and fifth and sixth of August in Ulidia Integrated College in Carrickfergus. That's Carl Verheyen. Brilliant. Dear Miss Anderson, I thought I ought to warn you of something before it's too late. John Bennett, in a desperate hunt for listeners, has now taken to cowardly tactics. The younger listener audience that you have recently made your own is now under threat from him. Ah, he's trying to winkle at them, picking away at them like a woodpecker. Did you see him nervously sneaking in that Belle and Sebastian track, hoping that the BBC producers wouldn't notice? It's a low blow, Jerry. I think you ought to warn him off. Tell him it should happen. Should it happen again, that you'll take to playing the Everly Brothers, or indeed the ultimate weapon of mass destruction that is known as Roy Orbison, or some of the other drivel that frequents his show. I know that you never actually do that, Jerry, because you're too good to resort to tit-for-tat audience theft. No, I've never resorted to that. Whenever people like Bennett and Jones have resorted to low-rent tactics, I've always turned the other cheek. Sometimes it's a mistake. All depends on who you're dealing with. But sometimes I feel as if non-cooperation and non-reply is the best reply. Have a nice day and don't say I didn't warn you. Thank you. From David Latimer, thank you very much indeed. Good morning. Hello.
Hello.
Good morning. I hope you're not one of them.
No, I am not one of them, Jerry.
Well, there are plenty of them about, you know.
And I think you're much better than John Bennett.
No, it's not a question of being better than someone, it's a question of being purer.
Purer, you're
you'll understand that being a woman.
Oh, of course I do.
Pure as the white snow.
Absolutely.
It's important to see that we have our ethics correct. You see, many of the broadcasters do not care what happens to them. Ah. All they want is popularity. See, I'm worried about my soul. I will not lose my soul in the bid for listeners. Many of them have sold their soul to whatever passes for the devil.
Ah, but you see, Jerry, you've got the charm.
And the charisma.
And the charisma to go with it.
Exactly. So I can afford to rise above them, rise above that swamp.
Absolutely.
In which they all wallow. But John Bennett, I would have thought more of him. I used to quite admire him until I realised that he dyes his head.
He does not.
He doesn't dye his hair, he has none, he dyes his head. Do you think that's his natural colour? He used
no.
to be a white man, now he's red. But anyway, I know you don't want to get into all this stuff. This is all just my bile. And my gnarled and twisted perceptions of the fellow workers. See how excited I get?
Absolutely, Jerry.
Okay, I'll stop now, because after all, this is your BBC, and remember that.
Yes.
What can we do for you today as a representative of the BBC?
Well, my brother and 29 others are walking from Annagrey and Donegal to the Glens of Antrim to raise funds for cancer research.
I'll tell you what, I know Annagrey.
You see.
And Annagrey is a very wind-blown place in the summer. And, you know, words defy me to describe it in the winter. But even in the summer, it's like the Antarctic.
Well, left Annagrey this morning at 9:30.
My God. They must be almost near death by now.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And it's really just to get people, you know, to encourage them along the way.
Yes.
And just to swell their thumbs for cancer research. And just to give them loads and loads of support.
It's 30 of them then.
30 of them.
From Annagrey to where?
From Annagrey to Carnlough in the Glens of Antrim.
That's a hell of a hike.
Burning. It's 150 miles.
Absolutely. As Wendy Austin would say.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'll tell you what, they'll have bunions at the end of that.
No, there will not indeed. These are all experienced walkers and they've put in loads and loads of hours
have they?
Training.
Have they?
For this very good cause.
Well, how will they identify themselves? Will they be jingling boxes and doing stuff like that?
Yes, they probably will. The people in Donegal so far have been very generous with them.
Yes, people in Donegal are nice like that, yes, they are.
And the money that they collect going through Donegal is going to stay in Donegal. And what does it come, sir?
Base in Guantanamo.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. So whatever they... I mean, except they're doing it along the way, the money they collect in a particular area, they keep it in that area? Is that the way it is?
No, just the ones... just the money that the Donegal is staying in.
Okay, of course, because it's different
then,
jurisdiction, obviously, as a gesture.
And then whatever they collect up here will all go to cancer research.
Mm-hmm. Donegal is not great this time of year, to be honest with you. This summer has been a terrible disappointment to me. I was down in Donegal. What day is today? This is Monday, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I was down in Donegal yesterday. It's not great. The weather is very depressing.
Well, now, so far, they are absolutely enjoying it.
Oh, well, that's good. You see, they can obviously rise above it.
Uh-huh.
Well, good luck to them, and I hope a lot of people support them in what they do, and it's a hell of a hike.
It is indeed.
And why aren't you on it? Maybe perhaps you're not in a position to. I don't know.
No, well, we are going to join them on Friday. We will walk the last 30 miles with them.
Well, the last 30 miles?
Yes.
Well, that's a fair distance as well.
It is. It's a fair wee walk.
It's not as if it's the last 100 yards left.
Uh-huh.
30 miles, that's like walking from Belfast to where? Newry? No.
Yep.
Is it? Belfast to where?
It'll be walking from...
I was going to say Portadown, but I mean, you wouldn't
Belfast
do that.
Belfast to Larne.
Yes, Belfast to Larne, yeah. Okay, we got that sorted out.
Uh-huh.
Took us a while. All right, then, well, thank you very much indeed.
Not at all, and thank you for having me on your show.
Not at all, it's a pleasure.
And we will continue to listen.
Okay, please do.
Thank you very much, Jim.
All right, then, bye.
Thank you now, bye-bye.
Bye. I got a letter, and it was addressed Pastor Kenny, BBC Radio Foyle, Derrystoke, Londonderry, and it was returned twice. We said, not at this address. But anyway, the guy got finally through. I don't know how it got here, but here it is now. It's a poem about our singles night. Our singles night, we have them on a regular basis. Not for any profit, of course. That's only Mr. Coyle demands money. I of course, refuse all denarii, as it used to be, but it's now euro. I refuse all offers of gold, because I find that money corrupts one, and I will not be corrupted. Mr. Coyle is hungry for it, but I don't need it. Our next singles night is on July 31st. It's only a couple of weeks' time in Newcastle, in the Sleeve Donald Hotel. And the man who wrote to me, writing to Father Pastor Kenny, care of BBC Radio 4, and got his letter sent back, wrote a poem on this. It's a projected poem. It's singles night in Newcastle, with the dancers on the floor, the music and the crack are good. Now who can ask for more? Jerry turns to Sean Coyle and says, "Something's not quite right." Look across at Geordie Tuft. Do his trousers look a little tight? Sean looks across the ballroom at the bulge in Geordie's pants. With envious eyes, he turns and sighs. Well, we can't have all our wants. Now, Geordie's on the dance floor. He's the darling of the girls. He has them captivated, and he twists and turns and whirls. But it isn't Geordie's footwork that drives the girls astray. What has them fascinated is his prominent display. As Geordie struts and poses with the ladies in a trance, a furry little creature emerges from his pants. It's like alien. The ladies scream in terror as en masse, little French there, as en masse they flee. A little ferret scampers round, delighted to be free. Geordie stands there in disgrace, half the man he was before. His trousers now hang from his braces, his pride upon the floor. Jerry Anderson is livid. He cries, "You've ruined the day. You've brought a ferret to the ball and chased all the girls away." But Geordie isn't shaken. Says he, "Why all the fuss? It was just a little augmentation down around my truss. The foxy women enhance their charms with silicone implants. Then surely I can do the same with a ferret down my pants." I'm sorry about that. There are people listening who don't approve of that kind of ribald rhyme, but I apologise. Doggerel, I think it is. Some people like that doggerel, but I can't make up my mind personally. A little rough for me.
Bobby sits by his window and watches the rain. Stares out the window out at the rain. No one knows what he's seen. No one knows where he's been, but he's been there. There's no fire to keep your body warm. Bobby watches the winter as she blows. He feels the winter as she blows. No one sees what he sees. No one hears what he hears. They're not listening. There's no fire to keep your body warm. Don't it leave you sad and lonely, lying in that empty room alone.
Sorry, I was on the machine there. Sorry, that's a song called... Let me just check what it was. Bobby Sits by the Window. It's from a singer called Denise Frank. You Don't Know Me, it's called. The album is called You Don't Know Me. Somebody sent that to me from Texas. I have no idea why, but thank you anyway for that. And look, I'm completely lost now. I was doing something there, and I have no idea what I'm doing. Oh, yes. No. I don't know what I'm doing. Let me just check. I'm going to play a little song there. That's it. I'm going to play another little... There we go. Just play this going up to the thing. See, that happens when you get lost and you forget. You forget what you're doing. It happens to me all the time. But sure, I don't mind. It's just the way things go. Go. And so why don't you come, why don't you come with me? I'm telling you every day I can play, I can sing, I can do anything you wanna see. So why don't you come down with me? Glad you came down and I'll thank you, mister. I'll thank you more if you bring your sister. Loving on her that needs lodging. And I play better with girls watching. Hey, that's why I play. So why don't you come with me? And then do it every day. I play, I can sing, I can do everything. Wanna see? So why don't you come? That's a fella called Paul Gilbert. That's a song called Girls Watching. Sorry, I'm back now. Sorry, I was distracted there a moment ago. I was in the middle of doing something very important. I forgot that the record was playing. I forgot that when it stops playing, you have to have another one on. We'll be back after the news approximately 4 minutes past 11 o'clock.
92 to 95 FM.
And 1341 medium wave.
BBC Radio Ulster.
It's 11 o'clock. This is the news with Alison Black. An EasyJet plane preparing to take off from Belfast International Airport has been involved in an accident with a service vehicle. It's understood the stationary aircraft was damaged when baggage was being loaded into the hold of the 9:30 flight to Amsterdam this morning. An EasyJet spokeswoman said it was an unfortunate incident. None of the 139 passengers on board was hurt. Alternative arrangements are being made to take them on their journey. Engineers are currently assessing the damage to the aircraft. A report by the Independent Monitoring Commission on Demilitarisation is now with the British and Irish governments and is expected to be published tomorrow. The four-member commission is expected to talk about its findings at a news conference in Belfast tomorrow. It's the second report by the commission. Its first in April reported on continuing paramilitary activity. A man has died in a road accident in Downpatrick. The crash on Bells Hill happened at around 8 o'clock this morning and involved a car and two lorries. Several people were injured but are not thought to be seriously hurt. Meanwhile, in County Donegal, a 30-year-old man was killed in a road accident just across the border from Londonderry. He was a passenger in a car which hit a stone bridge in the Carrigans area. The Commissioner of the Metropolitan Police, Sir John Stevens, will report to the Home Office on how secret files about preventing terrorist attacks on Heathrow Airport were published in The Sun. The confidential files listing possible sites where missiles could be launched were given to the newspaper by a driver who found them on the road. The Home Secretary, David Blunkett, told the BBC that it was very bad that such a sensitive dossier had been lost. A petrol tanker apparently driven by a suicide bomber has exploded near a petrol station in Baghdad. It's thought to have killed at least 10 people. Witnesses say the tanker appeared suddenly as officers were lining up to be told their duties for the day. It exploded without warning, causing widespread damage. Lloyds TSB has admitted breaking the banking code by failing to assess whether a customer living on benefits was able to repay a loan of £20,000. The case features in an edition of BBC One's Real Story to be broadcast this evening. The BBC's business reporter, Howell Jones, has the details.
The producers of Real Story looked at the case of a jobless couple living in Staffordshire who were already in debt and living on benefits. The couple took out a series of loans with a branch of Lloyds TSB in Burton-on-Trent, the final loan totalling £20,000. The programme makers say a large proportion of the money the couple borrowed was to cover interest and the cost of loan insurance. A director of Lloyds TSB, interviewed by Real Story, admitted there had been a breach of the banking code. The bank should have made a proper assessment of whether the couple were able to repay the money. Lloyds TSB told the BBC that one breach in one bank is one too many.
And the weather, some brief sunny intervals, but it will become cloudy with scattered showers, some heavy and prolonged, the maximum temperature 18 degrees. Tonight, the showers will ease for a time, but further rain will return by morning. BBC Radio Ulster News.
BBC Radio Ulster.
Travel news. Following a road traffic accident at Bells Hill in Downpatrick, part of the main Downpatrick to Crossgar road has been closed. Police are advising motorists to expect delays or to avoid the area completely if possible. Cars will be diverted along the Crossgar Road East and lorries via the Annacloy Road. Finally, on the railways, an 8 o'clock Enterprise from Belfast to Dublin is running 2 hours late, and the Belfast to Derry line passengers can expect delays of about 20 minutes. Sarah Dobson reporting.
Travel news from BBC Radio Ulster.
Hello, I'm David Dunseith, and in Talkback today, be prepared, an idiot's guide to warding off superbugs, the papal freak show, why the Pope shouldn't come to Ireland, and faking it, crying whiplash may become harder than you think. That and more in Talkback after the news at noon.
Thank you, David. Welcome back. Gerald Anderson here, coming up to 5 minutes past 11 o'clock. The number to ring if you want to contact this programme is 08459 555 678. Email address, gerry.anderson@bbc.co.uk. Here's an interesting combination. Have a listen to this. This is B.B. King and George Jones.
I was born and raised down in Alabama on a farm way back up in the woods. Boy, I was so ragged, folks used to call me Patches. Papa used to tease me about it. But deep down inside, Dad was hurting, cause he'd done the best he could.
My papa was a great old man. I can see him with a shovel in his hand. Education that he never had. But he did wonders when the times got bad.
a little money from the crops we raised, barely paid the bills we made.
Oh, life whipped him down to the ground when he tried to get off, life would kick him back down. On the day Papa called me to his dying bed, placed his hand on my shoulders and in tears he said,
Patches, I'm depending on you, son, to pull the family through. My son, it's all left up to you.
And 2 days later, Papa passed away, and I became a man that day. So every day I had to work the fields, 'cause that's the only way we got our meals. See, I was the oldest of the family, and everybody was depending on me.
Now years have passed and everybody's grown. Mama's been living in a brand new home. Lord knows it took a lot of sweat and tears, and my daddy's voice to help us through the years. He said,
Patches, I'm depending on you, son, to pull the family through. My son, it's all left up to you.
Daddy had been sick for a long time, flat on his back. Every evening after we'd finish our chores and eat our dinner, we'd all go into Papa's room to cheer him up a little. And this particular day, Dad was in good spirits, sitting on the side of the bed telling Mama how good she looked. When all of a sudden, Papa had a pain in his chest. I was too young to understand, talking about a heart attack here. Mama rushed us all out of the room into the hallway. About 10 minutes later, she came out with tears in her eyes. She called out to me, Patches, Patches, get in here, boy. Your daddy wanna see you. I went running into Papa's room. There Papa lay. Daddy had tears in his eyes. I knew something was wrong, because Daddy was a poor man, but all of my life, he'd been a proud man. I knelt down on one knee beside the bed. Papa put his hand on my shoulder. He said, Patches, Patches, boy, the hammer of life done beat your old papa down to the ground, and I ain't got nobody to turn to take care of Mama and the young'un. So what I want you to do, to promise me, son, is that you're gonna do your best to help your Mama as much as you can. I said, Papa, I'm gonna do my best. But little did I know then, like I know now, that trying to climb life's mountain, searching for a top where there ain't no top, sometimes you find yourself frustrated, lazy. But every time I feel like I can't live my life like I want to, my mind goes back to that day when I see those tears in my daddy's eyes. But most of all, I remember his words. Patches, I'm depending on you, boy. Every time I feel like giving up, I hear his voice. Patches, 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 Patches.
I'm depending on you, son. I try to do my best. It's up to you. I'm depending on you, son. I've tried to do my best. It's up to you to do the rest. Patches, I'm depending on you, son, to pull the family through. My son, it's all.
Well, that's a fairly half-hearted B.B. King, I think. That's with George Jones. That's an interesting record, that is called Patches. It's from an album called Rhythm, Country and Blues, featuring on that particular track George Jones and B.B. King. I always noticed that George B.B. King always tends to do things that people expect him to do, and he does them half-heartedly, kind of perfunctory. I could have played the guitar better than that, I think, on that track. I think he's just saying to himself, what time is it? What time do I get home here? There's a documentary on the other month, it was on BBC Four, about the blues, written by a series by Martin Scorsese, and I was very annoyed to see B.B. King thanking Mick Jagger for making the blues popular. I said to myself, you could tell by his eyes that the producer said to him, listen, you better do that, it'd be great if you did that, thank all the white boys, thank all the English white boys for all your money. And you could see that he hated doing it, but you know, the point is he shouldn't have done it at all, but that's only my opinion, and what do I care? Hello, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, how are you?
Not too bad, Gary, and you?
What do you think of B.B. King apologising to the white English boys for making him money? Have you any thoughts on that, now?
No, not really. Gary, it's not my scene at all.
I didn't think so, but that's all right. There's not necessarily any reason why you should have an opinion on it. I'd just like to talk to somebody about it. But
I know.
What, tell me what your particular interest is.
My interest is I'm looking for Aaron Wool.
Well, that's nearly akin to the B.B. King controversy.
I know.
But maybe perhaps a different type of alfalfa.
Exactly.
You're looking for wool, you say?
I'm looking for iron wool. I got it a few months ago in Little. It was a three.
Little? That big expensive store?
That big expensive store. Brilliant it is.
You must have a few quid about you shopping down there, I'm telling you.
It saves us pounds and pounds. I'm running short of the grey colour in it. And I was just wondering if somebody about would have a ball just lying idle, can't do anything with it. I would be very appreciative of it.
Emma did that little one time and had to carry all my groceries in my arms.
Is that right? Oh, yes, so you have to buy your bags. You know, if you're getting the value, you have to bring your own carriage.
I didn't know he told me that.
Uh-huh.
I lifted a whole load of oranges and stuff, and I was looking around, and I had to carry them around my arms like some kind of... I felt like Harold Lloyd or Laurel and Hardy.
Cardboard boxes, Derek.
I didn't know you were supposed to lift cardboard boxes.
Oh, I'm going to...
What is this, Second World War?
It is.
You know?
It's still good.
So there was me all stacked up with things and an arm short.
I know, but you're as long.
So what do? You have to go and you get a cardboard box, do you?
It was just a few things in the cardboard box, Jerry. I lifted them out and I put my stock into it.
In other words, you take a cardboard box.
The bag.
In other words, you go up and if I see a cardboard box with two tins in it, take the tins out and you lift the cardboard box.
Exactly, put it on top of the other.
So that's like Oliver Twist would be doing that.
Well, I know it
the Artful
is,
Dodger.
Nevertheless,
that's what everybody does.
Well, you know what I mean? An old pensioner has to look after a penny.
No, but seriously, when you go in there, what are you supposed to carry your groceries in?
Well, you get a trolley.
I didn't see any trolleys. Where are the trolleys?
Outside? Yes.
But why is there no wee baskets and things?
No, there's no baskets now, Jerry.
Why is there no baskets?
No, not that I've ever seen.
Do they not trust us?
Well, they not. Well, if I see you coming in now, Jerry, that's a different kettle of fish, you know, because we're bound down, do you?
Well, my stuff fell all over the floor and I had to grovel around like an idiot and pick it all up and put it in my pocket. Now, if you put it in your pocket, they accuse you of shoplifting.
Well,
I've been accused of that before and it's no joke, I'm telling you.
Jerry,
I was hauled up before.
Were you?
I was accused of shoplifting before,
Oh, my goodness.
I've done everything, you know.
As well.
There's no felony you can think of I haven't been accused of. What?
You have your finger in every pie, Jerry.
I'm afraid so. I wish I could get my finger out of some of them. Anyway, what kind of wool are you looking for?
I'm looking for Aran. Grey Aran wool. They had it in a three-pack thing. And it was very reasonable. It was 99p for the three balls. And I got all the colours, but I'm down to the grey now, and I'm short of a ball. One ball.
Well.
And if anybody about has it, it's Classico, that's the name of it.
What is it?
Classico, that's the name of it.
All right then. Okay, anyone out there's got something like that?
Yes.
Right, okay.
Thank you very much, Jerry.
Not at all, it's a pleasure.
Bye. The Lord bless you.
All right then. Bye. Bye. Well, that was exciting.
So wonderful, a miracle. Oh, it was beautiful, magical. And all the birds in the trees, well, they'd be singing so happily, oh, joyfully, oh, playfully, watching me.
That's Supertramp. That's a song called The Logical Song. Hello, good morning.
Good morning.
Yes, guys. Hello, how are you?
I'm not too bad. Well, that would be an exaggeration. About 5 days ago, my wife got me to plant a couple of flowers and two of those ornamental pots outside the front of the house.
Yes.
And as I bent down, there was this sensation of snapping braces, which I don't wear, and this numbing pain. It knocked my back out, so I'm only out of bed after 5 days. I'm actually standing here. I can't sit in the seat.
Well, it's your wife's fault.
I know, but she won't accept the responsibility.
Of course they won't, no, but why doesn't she appreciate the fact that if it wasn't for her, that you'd be okay?
Well, she says she's guilty, but I don't know if she's bluffing or not.
No, she doesn't accept her responsibility in your demise. It's obviously, if she hadn't asked you to do that, you'd have been fit and well today.
Well, I know.
So she must pay.
What would you reckon?
I don't know. I think perhaps, I don't know. It's difficult. I don't know what you like. I need to talk to you more about what your particular preferences are.
Well, what I was going to ask you was, and maybe she would buy me this, are you familiar with a music sequencer?
I am.
Yeah, I thought you would be.
Yes.
Well, I'm a bit like yourself. I listen to the program quite regular, and I've observed you're a bit of a technophobe at times.
Yes.
And I am myself.
Uh-huh.
Now, this is a little music sequencer. I play guitar. I only play by ear, you know. I don't understand music. I can't write music.
Most of the best people don't.
Well, I enjoy it. That's the main thing, yeah. You know. But I had a notion of getting this little music sequencer.
Uh-huh.
And it has the potential to put real good backings on it.
Yeah.
Backing tracks.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, a lot of these things, when you go to these shops, these guys could sell some to the Arabs.
The guys with the short ties. I've seen those guys. And the acne.
Yeah.
Guys, the white shirt, short tie, and acne. Don't buy anything from them.
That's right.
They have no idea what they're talking about.
No, I haven't focused.
No, that's a clue.
Maybe you find when you get this thing home, you need to be a rocket scientist to be able to operate it.
Yeah.
And it's a wee machine called a Yamaha QY100.
Yes.
And it's only about maybe 7 inches long by about 5 inches wide.
Yeah.
By about 1.25 inches deep.
Yeah.
But I know I've heard one before, and there are fantastic voices on it. You know, there are some very realistic sounds on it.
Yeah.
That convince you, you know.
It would convince even a skeptic.
Yeah. Such as myself.
Indeed. Taken in right away. Taken in right, left, and centre at every possible opportunity.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, I would like to know if there would be anybody in the area where I live here that would have one that I could go and have a bit of crack with.
In other words, you want to find out how it works.
Yeah.
That's basically what you're trying to find out, how it works. Right, well, I can't help you there because you either can work a Yamaha QY100 or you can't. Right? But you can learn.
Yeah,
but
well...
You're not going to learn from the guy in the shop because he doesn't know either.
I know that.
He'll tell you he knows, but he doesn't know.
This is why I'm hoping that there'll be somebody about the area that would have one that I can maybe sit down with and see will it be realistic to buy it or not. They're about £300.
Well, have you got an instruction booklet?
Jerry, when I lift these instruction booklets and try to do what they say they do, it doesn't happen.
You see, you have to persevere. You may be reading it with the wrong eyes. You see, get somebody else's eyes.
Maybe the wrong glasses on.
No, but these things are terrible. You know, I know. I've grappled with these things before. You're far better. You're absolutely right. You're far better talking to someone who has one.
Uh-huh.
And they've already worked it out themselves without looking at the instruction booklet, which will tell you everything but nothing that you can understand. Yeah. All right, then. So what area do you live in?
I live in a little place called Ballyrolle. It's between Mullyle and Ballywalter.
Ballyrolle?
Yeah.
God, I've never heard of that. How do you spell Rolle? R-O-L-Y?
R-O-L-L-E-Y.
You've got the two L's?
Yeah.
All right, I've never heard of that. Sorry, I'm yawning. It's not your fault. It's just that I don't sleep half an hour. Ballyrolle, it's near Mullyle.
It's just, yes, round about the Mullyle area. Well, by the way, there's something that I have to take you up with.
Yes.
I listen to the programme regularly.
Yes.
And I like the crack between you and Sean.
Yes.
I notice that he's a bit intimidated when you're not there.
Yes.
He took the programme one week when you weren't there, and it wasn't the same Sean.
No, he gives away prizes.
He lets away, he can let loose at you, you see, and he just doesn't seem to be comfortable when you're not there.
No, I'm his punch bag. He plays Dean Martin and everything.
Yeah, but there's one thing that I have observed a conversation between you and him a number of times.
Yeah.
This inside leg measurement.
I'm afraid it's something that we've discussed on a regular basis, yes.
Uh-huh. And I feel that you've arrived at this erroneous measurement in one of four ways.
Yes.
One, somebody has cut 3 inches off the tape.
Yes.
And you haven't made allowances for that.
What are you trying to say here? You're trying to say that I've given a false inside leg measurement? Is that what you're trying to say?
Something like that.
It's 32.
Second, the feather, instead of measuring to the ankle bone,
yes,
measured to the floor.
Well, I've never been accused of that before. No, let me just say this to you. I have been a man who was friendly with a man who used to work in Burton's.
Right.
I was once measured round the pole in Burton's. Did you ever hear about that?
No.
There was a time, do you remember years ago when the only place you'd get a suit made was Burton's?
That was a time I had one made there.
Exactly, and you could pay 10 bob a week. And you didn't have to pay the whole thing, and you got a book and everything.
That's right.
And you could go up and get a suit.
Uh-huh.
Well, I went up to Burton's one time, and I'm sure Burton's won't mind me saying this, because, you know, the man who is employed by them, sorry, who was employed by them, is long gone. He's still alive, but he's no longer an employee of Burton's, so I can speak with impunity,
uh-huh,
as the politicians say. Anyway, I went in to him, and I said, I'd like a suit. And uh-huh, we went through the patterns. No, you go through the books. And you pick your shade of grey. You pick the shade of grey that you like.
Yeah.
And then you should say, what do you want now? What bottoms do you want? And you say, 14 bottoms or 16? You get 16. Because 14's too teddy boy. And then you decide if you want your buttons covered or not.
Uh-huh.
Do you remember that?
Yep.
And what else did you decide? You decide whether you want a box jacket or if you want figured.
Single breasted, slimline lapels.
Exactly. If you want slimline lapels, you want wide lapels. And indeed, if you're really flush, you could get, yeah, wait for it, two pairs of trousers.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And then did you want fingertip drip?
Exactly. And did you want a wee pocket on the inside for your fags?
That's right.
Do you remember the wee pockets for your fags?
Yeah, and that was the time you used it.
You see. And did you want double breasted or single breasted? And did you dress to the left or the right? I won't ask that question because it's a personal thing. But anyway, I went in there and he said, right, so I'm going to measure you up now. And he had been out. He was a fellow who used to play in a band. I won't give his name because it's not fair. He used to play, he used to moonlight. He played in bands, you see. So sometimes he didn't get any sleep at all. And he'd go in there on a Saturday in particular. He'd be out playing on a Friday night. And he'd be, his eyes would be literally stuck together. You know, he'd be just standing there no more. And he's just trying to, you know. It was as if he was drunk. But he wasn't drunk. He was just extremely tired. He was like, you know, like being in Castlereagh for four days. You see, so he measured me. And he measured me around the chest. He says, 48.
He must have thought you were around a bust of machines.
You see, and then he wrote down 48, and I said, that's not right. He said, there it is, look, you've seen it yourself, that's 48. I said, 48? I said, you know why it's 48? He said, you notice where I'm standing? I said, what? I said, do you notice where I'm standing? I'm standing beside a pole. I said, you have measured the pole as well. I was standing by the back, not by back to the pole, but, you know, near the pole. No one's poles used to be in old-fashioned shops.
Yeah, yeah.
The pole in the middle of the floor. And he put the tape around the pole and he measured that as well. I said, and if I hadn't stopped him, I would have got a 48-inch jacket. Can you imagine what that would have been like on me? And I was like a 32 at the time. It's another foot. Anyway, can you still get a suit made in Burton's, I wonder?
Well, I wonder about that because I was talking to a guy here. A lot of the young fellas, you know.
I don't think you can.
You remember, if you remember, off the peg clothes were terrible then.
Oh, never. Even today, to this moment, I cannot wear anything off the peg. Because I'm an in-betweeny.
Yeah.
I'm in between sizes.
What would that be?
Well, I'm not going to specify. But you know the way you get a 38 and a 40?
Yeah.
Well, I'd be a 39. Right. I'm a 37. You see, the smallest kind of gents jacket you can get, really, and any off the peg things, kind of like a 36.
Uh-huh.
You know, that's, you know. But a 36 is too wee for me. And then the next one's a 38. And that's too big for me. So I'm a 37.
But like my socks.
What are your socks?
Well, they give you things from 6 to 11.
And what are you, 12? Well, you know what they say about a man with big feet.
No.
You can't get socks to fit you. And another thing as well, which I used to... No, I don't think you can get a suit in... But I have a great man. I can't tell you his name because that would be advertising.
Aye.
I have a great man who looks after me. I have some lovely suits. His name is John McBride.
I'll show you on the white one.
He looks after me. And you should go to him. Do you want a suit made? I'll send you the right man. Need you a few quid about you, though.
Well, now you're scaring me there.
There's no point.
Was it him that got the 32 inside leg?
No, it wasn't him, no.
Oh, it wasn't
him, no.
Have you worried about that, you say?
You see, there's certain things that men don't know. Now, for instance, Mr. Coyle knows nothing. You see, he'll go in, he'll just lift anything. But you see, there are certain men who cannot dress themselves off the peg. It can't be done. These men are just the wrong size and the wrong shape. They will not get anything to fit them off the peg. Mr. Coyle's the same because his legs are deformed.
Oh.
Just naturally deformed, you know, nothing serious, just naturally. One of them is not the same as the other. So he doesn't have any kind of mission bound trousers. He looks as if he's been hit by a hammer. Anyway, when men go in and they go into off the peg shop, see, they have only all the choices to go to someone to get something made for them, right? So the mistake that these men made, before they do that, they buy off the peg suits. And it's a mistake to buy an off-the-peg suit if you don't exactly fit. So you have to go to a man. So anyone who wants to know where to get a really nice suit, I can tell them. But I'm not going to say it on the air because it's not fair.
Do you ever remember Pat McAllister?
Why does that name ring a bell?
Well, Pat McAllister was a tailor in Belfast.
Really?
And all the guys went to him. He was a class tailor.
You see.
You paid for it.
Well, you see, you always get what you pay for.
Well, usually a lot of guys went to Pat McAllister that wanted to have shoulders about 3 times as wide as they normally would.
Ah, Sean Connery jobs, yeah.
And after about a fortnight, they were hanging down around their elbows.
Well, you see, this is what happens. You see, if there's nothing to hold up the shoulder will naturally go down.
Right.
It's what's called gravity. But there is some... I used to have a great wee man in Dublin. I lived in Dublin for a long time. I was so happy then. And I lived in Dublin, and I had a little man then who's gone now.
Uh-huh.
A little Jewish tailor. And he was lovely. He was a great man. He used to do everything himself. And he used to say, "That's not quite right. It's not quite right." And he keep it coming back. When you got a suit, you come in about 4 or 5 times. 4 or 5 times you come in.
Yeah.
And he'd look at you and change. And then even at the very end when he had it done, he said, "No, I can't let you walk out in that. Can't let you walk out in that. Can't let you walk out in that. It's not right." And but then you get the other kind. I remember used to go into a little shop in London. I was there for a while before I was hunted. And there's a lovely little shop there, a little Jewish tailor shop as well, but it wasn't tailors really, it was a place you could suits and stuff. And there used to be a man in there, and I used to go in every day. And I used to, not every day, but I used to go in about a couple of times a week, just for crack, because I enjoyed him.
Uh-huh.
And he used to always try and sell you things that were too big for you. You see, and I'd say, "That's a nice suit there." And he'd say, "Yeah, try on the jacket, it's lovely, try on the jacket, try it on, what you got to lose? Nothing, try it on." So I used to try on the jacket, it'd be like, you know, like 2 sizes too big. I'd say, "It's a little big." He said, no, not too big, not too big. You go anywhere in the world in that suit. You could go anywhere in the world. Yeah, I said, "You go anywhere in the world in that suit and it would still be too big." He said, no, you'll grow into it. I said, "No, thanks." Anyway, what did we start talking about? I can't remember.
I wonder, was that Jerry the same wee man? he committed murder.
Well, I don't think so.
And when he was up before the judge sentenced him to hang.
Uh-huh.
And he says, "Have you any last requests?" He says, "I have." He says, "Hang me from a gooseberry tree."
Yes.
And the judge says, "Sure, it's too low." He says, "Well, I'll wait till it grows."
You go anywhere in the world in that suit. Anywhere in the world. I mean, what were we talking about? Oh, your thing.
QY100.
Your Yamaha QY100. All right, anyone who knows how to operate a music sequencer. Of that particular variety and lives in the vicinity of Ballyroley, which is somewhere near Belial, give us a ring and we'll put them in contact with you. And so there we are. So maybe you'll make happy music together.
That sounds good, Jerry.
All right then.
And here on the parting, the last one of that erroneous inside leg measurement.
Yes. I'm still a 32.
I think you tell Porky.
What do you think? I'm a 28? I'm a 32. You could go anywhere in the world with my inside leg. Anywhere in the world.
But 29, 29 and a half.
I'm a 32. And I'm sticking to that. Right.
Did you hear the story of the old farmer and his son were standing in the field?
No.
And the old farmer looked up and he said, "There's your wife and my wife and your mother coming."
Yeah.
"That makes 5 of us. How did he get that?"
"Your wife."
"And my wife and your mother coming." This is the farmer speaking to his son.
Yeah.
"How did he get 5?
Well, he's obviously married twice, was he?
No.
What? Oh, I can't think of it. Your wife, my wife, and your mother.
Yep.
Your wife, so it'd be his son's wife. That's okay. My wife would be my wife, it'd be his mother, and your mother. And your mother. I have no idea. Tell me the answer quick.
That's quite easy.
What?
Similar to you, you couldn't count.
Oh, for God's sake. Thank you for that. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Jojo was a man who thought he was a loner, but he knew it couldn't last. Jojo left his home in Tucson, Arizona, for some California grass.
Back, Beatles, naked. Found a pair of gents' specs on the platform at Hollywood Railway Station on Friday. A mystery there. Lost budgie in the Finnahy area this morning. No mystery there. A riding hat has been found in the Dunmurry area. I'm saying nothing. Hello to Jerry Campbell of Springfield Road. Tell Jerry to cheer up. I'm all right. From his son Adrian. I think I'm okay. Maybe I'm not. I don't know. Am I all right? I don't know, maybe I'm depressed. I don't know. Hello to Caroline, Graham and Simone in Bristol. Please play A Boy Named Sue. There's no need for that. Also, hello to Liz in Belfast. Please play Charlie Lansborough. There's no need for that. And Barney Hallman in Germany, hello to him. Please play Chip Taylor. There's no need for that from Eamon. And a caller wants to... From Raymond, I'm sorry. A caller wants to know, does anyone have a copy of these songs? Goodbye, Old Ship of Mine, and The Shamrock Thistle and The Rose. Obviously, contemporary hits. Hello, good morning.
Hello.
Yes, good morning. How are you?
Is that Mr. Kelly?
No, it's not. It's Mr. Anderson here.
Oh, I'm off on the wrong foot right away.
I'm afraid you are. But I don't mind that. I know anyone can make a Freudian slip.
Jerry, I went into a shop on the Woodstock Road many years ago, a shoe shop.
Yes.
It was Mahoney's at the corner of My Lady's Road. It's no longer there, so I can mention the name.
Was it a victim of our troubles?
No, I don't think so.
Or the wrecking ball?
So, it's still there, actually. But
oh, is it?
I think it's a chemist shop now, but however.
Well.
But a long story short, you would recall baseball boots.
Yes, I do recall baseball boots. I used to hate them.
That we poor people had to wear.
Poor people had to wear. I didn't like them because they made your feet sweat and they made your feet sore.
That's right.
Because the soles are too thin.
Yes, well, I went in one day to buy a pair of baseball boots, you see, And I says to the boy, I want a pair of baseball boots. He says, what size? He says, I'm 14. Oh, he says, okay. So he gets up and he searches and he... Remember those old shoe shops with the ladders up? And
that's right, yeah, the fella had to go up the top, yeah.
And he was up pulling boxes and boxes down and checking. He says, I'm awful sorry. He says, that's a rare size.
It's a big size.
He says, I forgot to tell you, it's from a wee boy of 12.
Oh, lovely.
He thought they were for me, you know, so...
Oh, for God's sake. So 14 would be a wee tiny size.
That's all rings a bell of me, you know.
Yeah, I'm sure he'd be pleased at that.
He wasn't too pleased, but he was very diplomatic about it, you know. But I'm sure he called me a few names when I left the shop.
I wonder, has anyone got a pair of baseball boots laying about the house?
You never see them. If they're a size 14, they probably belong to our Robert.
Yeah.
If he's listening.
They used to get very smelly too, didn't they?
Oh, they did, sure. Well, no thing about them. You hung them out in the lane, you know.
You could wash them,
yeah. But you couldn't have took them to the mender, that was the problem.
No, that was it. Once there was a hole. But it was quite fashionable to have a hole in them. Do you remember that? It's quite fashionable to have a... Remember they used to burst an odd time?
I remember sitting in a shop one day and a boy came in for a pair of he wasn't a very well-to-do looking fella, and
no.
He got a pair of baseball boots, and it was a soaking wet day. I'll never forget it. And he took the old ones off and he put the new ones on, paid for them, and walked out and left the old ones behind him.
Well, obviously a pernickety consumer. Do you know the only place you'd see a pair of baseball boots now? The last time I seen a pair, and I'd be honest with you, was in a man who was sleeping rough in London.
Yeah.
You know the poor unfortunate guys who'd be lying on the pavement there, and you walk past them with your briefcase.
That's right. I haven't seen them for years.
Last time I seen a pair, because I remember looking at them and they looked as if they'd exploded.
That's right. Queer smell off them in the morning.
Yeah, there's a bit of a whiff, all right. And do you know the way they used to kind of explode like little volcanoes? It used to, well, when there was a hole in them, it used to get all kind of stringy around the edges. Do you remember that?
And then he played football on them, he made it worse, you know.
Exactly. No, only the foolish boy would play football and baseball boots, because you could hurt yourself very badly. Because there was no protection there. No protection.
No protection.
I'm almost tempted to ask someone to send me a pair, but I'm afraid that would be tempting fate.
Well, the thing is, if you open the box, you might have to open the windows as well.
Oh, my God. Stop. Well, what did they become? They became sneakers, didn't they?
Pardon?
They became sneakers.
Aye, well, I suppose they...
Well, I wonder when they stopped being called baseball boots.
Yeah.
There was a is that a dog there you have?
That's Candy.
What kind of a dog is that?
She's a border collie.
Well, seems quite healthy.
Oh, she's a good dog.
Defending your house against all comers?
That's right. Except if you bounce a big ball in front of her, I scared her when she was a pup.
Yes.
With a big ball. I kicked a big ball at her and it bowled her over.
And she never forgot it?
And ever since that, if she hears the thud of a ball, she runs.
Oh. a fearless watchdog.
All right.
All right then.
Okay,
thank you.
All right.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Bye. Hello, good morning.
Morning.
Good morning. Hello, who's that?
Sean from Enniskillen.
Yes, Sean, how are you? What's it like in Enniskillen today? I hope it's better than it is anywhere else.
Lovely, huh?
Is it?
Yeah.
Is the sun out?
Sun's shining.
Is it?
Yeah.
I wish you would come over here an odd time. I'm getting sad.
So am I. I'm getting fat.
Are you getting fat? Well, it's your own fault. People only get fat. Do you hear all this stuff about you know, lifestyle? The only people who get fat are people who stuff grub down them.
Well,
it's as simple as that.
You're Chinese.
You see, Chinese is always a mistake. Always a mistake. Monosodium glutamate. Well, how fat are you?
Well, I've put on a stone
When is this last?
6 months.
In 6 months? Well, that's not too bad.
It's only 10'4", now I'm 11'4".
Oh, that's, for God's sake, you're normal. You want to see some of the lumps I see walking about. No, you're okay, for God's sake. In many quarters, you'd be considered anemic. So what's the crack in this? Can you live there then?
Listen, I was watching a film on Saturday afternoon with the daughter, and she's 19 years of age. Right?
Yes.
She says to me, "Who's that man?" And I looked at her. I thought she was maybe talking about the actor, not the main actor. You'll be amazed when you hear who it was. She didn't know who it was.
I will be amazed at all, because I think I have an idea of what you're going to say.
Are you?
John Wayne?
Exactly,
yeah.
Yeah. There's three films on Saturday afternoon.
That's right.
And I was watching She Wore a Yellow Ribbon, and she said to me, "Who's that, man?"
You see.
I couldn't believe it.
You must remember that you're not as young as you used to be, and you're not as smart as you think you are either.
Exactly.
You see, there's a generation coming along now who don't know the people you know. And it's a big shock. but you see, they don't. They don't, you know. That's the thing. They don't. This is intimations of mortality.
True,
you see, you're realising that, you know, there's another wave of people coming along who care little about you. Oh, well, they care about you, but they care little about what your preferences are. Know nothing about you.
He's probably dead about 10 years, isn't he?
John Wayne is dead 30 years.
30 years?
Yes. You see, you don't... Yes, he is. Near enough. Near enough. He died in the 76 or 77.
Really?
Yes, you see, near enough 30 years. See, you don't realise that. You don't realise that. Sure, Mr. Sean Coyle, he talks about songs as if they were made yesterday. Songs 45 years old. You see? And 50 years old. And he talked about a movie 50 years old. He said, as if everyone had seen it. So you're the same. You see, you don't realise that the sands are... Well, the clock is ticking. And it's taken very quickly.
The film we were watching was made in 1949.
That is 55 years ago.
The one before, I can't remember.
55 years ago. That, how old is your daughter, 18?
19.
19? 55 years ago. But that film, before she was born, that film was 35 years old. You know, think about it.
True.
Think about it. You see, when you go back to when you were, remember you were born?
And it's called
Burn
I
the
Hope
Black
That
Suite.
I Don't Fall In Love With You from Burn the Black Suit.
That's it. Mm-hmm. Lady Smith Black Mambazo. In your case, it's like you watching a film that was made in 1912.
Right.
Like the Battleship Potemkin.
Yeah.
You'd have no idea what and who anybody was in it. See, you have to, you know, and there are people out there who don't know who Tyrone Power is.
True.
There are people there who are mystified at the sight of James Stewart and people like that. Who knows now? Who now talks of Rory Calhoun? Who now talks of Steve Cochran? And ask her about the Cowboys. Ask her if she knows Gabby Hayes. Ask her if she knows Hopalong Cassidy.
No.
Hey, hey, these are all people that you know, aren't they?
Used to go and watch them on the black.
Exactly. So your day is now. Your day has passed.
True.
All you do now is sit now and look out the window. That's all you can do now.
No.
time to let go. Give the rein to the young people who want to be in Big Brother. She'll come in.
That's nothing but crap now, kids.
Ah, but you see, it's our fault. You see, a lot of people are saying, and you have a certain amount of sympathy, that young people tend to watch crap. But you see, it's our fault. We made them. We made those people. We are responsible for them, and you cannot disassociate yourself from them. People who sit down and get really interested in and think that Big Brother is brilliant, it's our fault because we didn't bring them up properly. That's our fault. We gave them everything they wanted, and we told them that all the most important thing is having a good time and enjoying yourself.
That's exactly right. Yeah.
So they don't think anymore. We haven't encouraged them to think. It's our own fault. We're reaping the whirlwind, and they're going to be looking after us in about 20 years' time.
Hopefully.
So anyway, all I can say to you is, Shannon Doe.
Exactly. So
I love your daughter.
Thanks,
thank you. Bye.
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 My God, that's true. Hello. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes.
This is Curtis Murphy here.
Curtis Murphy.
Yes.
What a strange amalgam of a name.
Well, it's sort of.
You're crossing two cultures here.
Absolutely, from the south, originally
yes.
from Cork area.
Yes.
Potato famine time to the Caribbean.
You must be 150 now.
That's me, that's right.
You're getting on a bit.
Actually, it's quite interesting listening to your show and these guys who reminisce. When you get to your sort of mid-50s, you do start reminiscing, don't you?
Well, you see, I try and keep that to a minimum. But every once in a while, there are certain issues that have to be addressed.
Yes.
And the fact that a man can be amazed that his daughter doesn't know who John Wayne is, it says a lot about him.
That's true, actually. Now, I'm really actually giving you a bell to say how much I enjoyed a symphonic orchestra last night at the Ulster Hall.
Really? What was that?
It's the Loma Linda Academy. They're from Loma Linda in California.
Yeah.
And they are 93, aged 13 to 18,
yeah.
in this symphonic wind orchestra.
Uh-huh.
And they're phenomenal. Now, the organist obviously is a little bit older than 18. But combined the organ and their orchestra, it was absolutely brilliant.
Was there a good crowd at it? Was it well supported?
No, about 100 people in the whole of Ulster Hall.
Well, that's not a great smattering, is it?
Not really. But I thought I'd just give you a bell to say, part of the St. Anne's centenary celebration, they'll be at St. Anne's tonight at 8 o'clock.
St. Anne's Cathedral.
Yeah, and the organ will be in as well. And we've also got a plaque from the mayor of Loma Linda City.
Where is Loma Linda?
Loma Linda, California. Have you ever heard of the Loma Linda University, the medical center?
How do you spell that?
L-O-M-A, Loma.
Yeah. Yeah.
Linda, L-I-N-D-A.
Well, that's the way I would have spelled it if you had asked me to have a crack at it. Loma Linda, I've never heard of that.
Loma Linda on the north, west coast of...
No, I've never heard of it.
California.
Excuse my ignorance, but I've never heard of it.
Well, you know, there's a lot of places over here that I'd never heard of until I came over here.
I've never heard of Loma Linda, never.
There's a lot of bally over here, isn't there?
Yeah, there is indeed.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, a lot of bully as well.
Well,
so, can I say this to you? Is this the same, essentially the same show that was on last night in the Ulster Hall?
In essence, yes, but now that they're in a cathedral, obviously they'll be cutting back on some of the more secular stuff.
Less rock and roll. Well, a wee bit more restrained, perhaps.
Yes, but it's tremendous. They were at the Galway Arts Festival on Thursday night when we met the mayor of Galway, Kathleen, and they were at the Forum... Londonderry on Friday night.
Oh, is that this Friday night coming?
Last Friday night.
Oh, last Friday, I knew nothing about it.
And then they went on to the Ulster Hall yesterday.
Yeah.
St. Anne's today.
Yeah.
Tomorrow, lunchtime tomorrow, they'll be at St. Pat's in Dublin, but then coming back to my hometown, Banbridge.
Yes.
At the Banbridge Academy.
Okay.
At 7:30.
I wonder, are they a little disappointed at the... is it a general low turnout of people to see them?
Well, in Galway it was fantastic, but of course the festival's on. Derry, Londonderry was a little bit, again, low numbers.
Yeah.
They felt a bit disappointed. Yesterday about the same number, 100 or so.
Yeah, we tend not to come out for things in Northern Ireland.
Yes, so I gathered.
Unless it's Kerry McFadden or somebody.
But these guys are paying their own way, you know. These are academy students, and they have stomped up something like $200,000. And every time the dollar rate went down, of course, it hammers the price upward.
Of course it does, yeah.
So they've got three coaches, one lorry full of equipment and tubas and double basses and whatever. Well, these are brass, so it won't be double bass. It'll be one of those great big, kettle drums and all the rest of it.
It's probably a lambeg drum. it's trying to sneak its way in there.
One of the things that made me smile was they played the Danny Boy tune in Londonderry. Imagine a little Japanese fella with a tin whistle playing in front of an orchestra to play the Danny Boy tune. It was quite amazing.
Well, you see, this is what you want. The funniest thing, well, not the funniest thing I ever saw, the thing that I remember seeing a thing one time, which actually struck me as being a metaphor for all things that are wrong in Northern Ireland. There was a crowd of Japanese tourists, a small crocodile, if I use the term of Japanese tourists, being ferried around the centre of Derrystoke, Londonderry.
Mm-hmm.
And been shown the walls, of course. The walls, which, of course, are a magnificent sight. But for some reason, in Derrystoke, Londonderry, we tend to think that alcoholics were figures of fun.
Yes.
So we let guys lie around the street and get full. You see them, you say, oh, that's no problem. That's old Jimmy. Look, there's old Jimmy. Oh, full as a pool. We seem to think that's good crack, you see. And I don't know why, but we tend to not worry about them. But see, Japanese tourists kind of don't know that. So they were kind of walking along, and then this man appeared out of an alleyway with wild hair, wearing one shoe, roaring incomprehensibly, and waving what looked like an empty bottle of whiskey. And he headed towards the Japanese tourists at some rate of knots, you know. And to all intents and purposes, if I'd have been a Japanese tourist, I would have said to myself, here comes a man who's attacking me. But everybody, the people stand around, they start to laugh because, oh, it's only Jimmy. They don't realise that, you know, there's another perception here. And I
Absolutely.
Went, tourism is, we're in great shape here. Stocky's okay, so he means no harm. And the Japanese cringing in the corner, you know, saying, trying to get away. If they had a gun, they would have shot him. You know? Anyway, that's neither here nor there. So but there's nothing surprises me.
That triggers off a thought. When my daughter got married, we went to Nottingham Castle grounds for the photographs.
Yeah.
And a tourist bus of Japanese arrived.
Yeah.
And started taking her photograph, thought it was part of the pageant.
Well, you see. So you should have asked her for money. That's what I would have done. That'll be £2. Okay, then. Well, thanks very much. Best of luck with the rest of that tour with
St. Anne's tonight at 8 o'clock. The High Sheriff will be there to receive a plaque from the Mayor of Loma Linda.
The High Sheriff? That'll be John Wayne. Yeah. Okay, then.
Not quite, but enjoy your show.
See you later. Bye.
You smiling.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Manhattan to Seattle, you know everything grooves. From Boston to Bangkok, you know everything grooves. When a mother holds her newborn baby, with a love exceeding all expectations in her life, everything grooves, everything grooves. When you stay up all night to greet the morning sun, it's the only way to do it right. Everything grooves, everything grooves. From London to Melbourne, you know everything grooves. From Stockholm to Singapore, you know everything grooves. When all nations of the world lay down their arms, realizing the futility of the past, everything grooves, everything grooves. When all nuclear testing is laid to rest, and the world beneath the sea can forgive, everything grooves, everything grooves. From Dublin to Milan, oh, you know everything grooves. From Barcelona to Amsterdam, you know everything grooves. When the ceasefire was announced, I couldn't help but cry. Never thought it would happen in my life. Everything grooves, everything grooves. When Mother Earth embraces you in her loving arms, and you realize this is where you come from, everything grooves, everything grooves. From Belfast to Jerusalem, you know everything grooves. From Paris to Beirut, you know everything grooves. When you give your heart for the very first time, and love keeps you awake all the night, everything grooves. Everything grooves. When Groucho, Chico and Harpo dance, no one else has ever done it so right. Everything grooves, everything grooves. From Gothenburg to Geneva, you know everything grooves. From London to New York, you know everything grooves. From Dublin to Belfast, you know everything grooves. From Berlin to Bethlehem, you know, everything grooves. Everything grooves. Everything grooves. Everything grooves.
That's Francie Conway, and it's a bit like you found a Joan Baez record from 1967 and never got over it. But of course, many of us are like that. I'll be back tomorrow morning. If you want to write to me, write to Jerry Adams at care of BBC Radio 4, Derry, Stoke, London. Jerry, goodbye.
92 to 95 FM. BBC Radio Ulster.
It's time now for This Place. Today, Linda Mooney talks about the Broadway Picture House on the Falls Road, which was knocked down 10 years ago.
The outside of the picture house was covered in cream tiles, and you walked up three curving steps. You went in through the double doors, and there was a wee box at the side where you got your paper ticket. And then you went through the doors, and it was red carpet. None of us had carpet at home. There was red fitted carpet. And then you walked round the corner, and there was an usherette standing in a maroon uniform. And she took your ticket off you, and it wasn't very high tech. She put it on a big long bit of string with a knot tied in the other end. You went in there on a Saturday morning to the matinee, and you're in a completely different world. Our life in those days was very ordinary. We didn't have a television, you had the radio, and even our clothes weren't that colourful. And they were nearly all homemade. There was nothing fancy about them. But when you went to the pictures, the girls in the pictures were so glamorous, and they had city out dresses with big silk bows at the back, and they had curls in their hair, and they had silk ribbons. And the men, they were glamorous. They weren't like our mothers and fathers. And I was walking past it the other day, and there's, I think it's six houses there now, and they're lovely houses. But you wouldn't know that the Broadway had been there. Nobody, there's just no trace of it at all. This place that was a world of magic to me. Then I moved over to the Ormer Road, and it was great because it was the Curzon. But there must be something, I must have some sort of death wish on cinemas, because just as I was getting myself settled and enjoying as an adult going to the Curzon, I closed the Curzon. So now I haven't got a picture house in my own road. I have to go into town to the multiplexes, and they're not the same.